future. We can't.
Gotta go. Thank you, Miguel. Thank you, Miguel.
KPFA, KPFP, Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno.
Good evening. It's Tuesday, October 6th. President Trump back at work at the White House and in fine political fettle, if not in health, tweeting away today, including a repeat of his old canard, that the coronavirus pandemic is no worse than the seasonal flu, and sending a shock through even his own supporters by calling off any more talks with congressional Democrats over a new COVID economic relief bill. The coronavirus wreaking havoc with Trump's administration, senior Trump advisor Stephen Miller, plus two more on the communications staff, the latest sent to the sidelines by positive tests for COVID-19. And after a top Coast Guard commander test positive, the entire Joint Chiefs of Staff is in quarantine. Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden issues a sweeping call for national unity using the symbolic backdrop of Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, site of the bloodiest battle of the American Civil War, to warn that the U.S. again is in a dangerous place. Vice President Mike Pence rejects a plexiglass barrier for tomorrow night's debate with Democratic vice presidential candidate nominee Kamala Harris, and coronavirus fatigue beginning to afflict countries across Europe. From Pacifica Radio, KPFA in Berkeley, KPFK in Los Angeles, this is the evening news. I'm Mark Miracle. President Donald Trump's return to the White House is poised to reshape the campaign's final 4 weeks as aides debated today how to move past an extraordinary setback while grappling with how to send an infected president back out on the road. The race that had remained steady throughout the tumult now threatens to slip away from the president after he spent 72 hours hospitalized with COVID-19, the very disease that has fundamentally altered the country he leads and the campaign he wanted to run. The president, in his first full day back in the executive mansion, plunged Washington into further chaos by abruptly ending coronavirus relief talks. Trump had stage-managed his dramatic, if reckless, re-entry to the White House last night, taking off his mask before stepping back inside, and was pushing aides to return to the campaign trail as soon as possible, including to next week's second debate against Joe Biden. But as the president remained contagious, his health under careful watch, a division emerged between aides over how to manage the fallout. Some believe the moment could act as a late reset, allowing the president to draw from his own experiences and to at last show some empathy for those affected by the pandemic. But others believe that abruptly changing course after 7 months of projecting strength over the virus wouldn't work, and instead advocating for intensifying the message. Trump made clear what he wanted, portraying himself as the leader who stood up to the coronavirus and faced it down.
I stood out front. I led. Nobody that's a leader would not do what I did. And I know there's a risk, there's a danger, but that's okay. And now I'm better, and maybe I'm immune. I don't know. But don't let it dominate your lives. Get out there. Be careful. We have the best medicines in the world.
Don't be afraid of the coronavirus, Trump said. He did not mention the 210,000 Americans who have died from COVID-19, or the more than 7 million who have contracted the virus, some of whom suffer lingering and debilitating health effects. Kentucky's Democratic Governor Andy Beshear pleaded with Trump to set a better example as cases rise in his state, and he contradicted Trump's message not to fear the virus.
No, we need to have a healthy fear of a pandemic that's killed 1,200 Kentuckians, 200,000 plus Americans. That's more than we lost in multiple wars. We have to have a healthy fear of a virus, and if we don't, other people pay the price. I don't know if it was an attempt to sound macho or what the impetus behind it was, but I mean, the president's surrounded by doctors and no one else is. So I hope we all have a healthy fear of a worldwide health pandemic that has killed so many people and is going to continue to kill people.
For months, President Trump has tried to make the race a choice of an election between himself and Joe Biden, but his COVID diagnosis ensured, again, that his two safe harbors, the economy and the United States Supreme Court, were cast off the stage by the pandemic. And Trump himself seemed to add to that today by suddenly announcing he was pulling out of White House talks with congressional COVID-19 relief negotiators, blasting House Speaker Nancy Pelosi and seeming to accept the politically damaging responsibility for ending negotiations that were already on life support. Almost immediately, the stock market fell. William Denslow reports.
President Trump's announcement sent the major U.S. indexes tumbling down more than 1% by the close of trading. In a series of tweets, the president said Democrats were negotiating in bad faith and informed his representatives to stop negotiations until after November's election. Democrats have proposed another round of coronavirus spending in the region of $2.2 trillion, while Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin wanted the figure closer to $1.6 trillion. President Trump says the US is leading the world in its economic recovery. But on Tuesday, Federal Reserve Chair Jerome Powell called for more stimulus, warning that the recovery had a long way to go. William Denslow, New York.
The coronavirus cast a long shadow over the White House, where more positive cases among staff were reported today, and rooms in the residence were being converted into workspaces for the president. Stephen Miller, Trump's senior advisor and speechwriter and architect of the administration's most xenophobic immigration policies, tested positive for the coronavirus today. So did two more members of the White House communications staff. A senior administration official said Miller had previously tested negative as White House officials have tried to contain the outbreak in the complex that has infected Trump, the First Lady, and more than a dozen other aides and associates. Miller is author of the President's America First Foreign Policy and his most restrictive immigration measures. Meanwhile, America's top military leaders are under self-quarantine after a senior Coast Guard official tested positive for the coronavirus. The Pentagon said the chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Mark Milley, and the vice chair, General John Hyten, were among those affected. Military leaders who were in contact with Admiral Charles Ray, the vice commandant of the U.S. Coast Guard, were told last evening that he had tested positive. They were all tested this morning with none exhibiting symptoms or have so far tested positive. Ray was in a meeting of the Joint Chiefs of Staff late Friday morning in what's called the tank, the classified meeting room in the Pentagon. Officials said this is where most of the military leaders were exposed to him, but he also had meetings with other officials. The head of a Southern California mega church announced he has contracted COVID-19. Pastor Greg Lurie may have been infected at the apparent super spreader event when President Trump introduced his Supreme Court nominee at the White House Rose Garden last month. Most who attended did not wear masks or maintain a safe physical distance from each other. Lurie said in a Facebook post he tested positive last Friday and has been in quarantine. Before attending the Rose Garden ceremony, Lurie participated in the prayer march on the National Mall with Vice President Mike Pence. Meanwhile, Pence wants no plexiglass divider on his side of the stage at tomorrow night's vice presidential debate after an announcement by the Commission on Presidential Debates that dividers had been agreed to as a safety measure to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. Mark Short, the vice president's chief of staff, said his team does not view plexiglass dividers as medically necessary, given other safety measures at the debate, including a 12-foot distance between Pence and Senator Kamala Harris and daily testing of COVID-19 for both candidates. The commission and the Biden campaign both said today they understood that the Pence team had been in agreement with the notion of plexiglass barriers. But the Pence team suggested they did not want any such dividers around the vice president, regardless of what Harris does. Short said if she wants it, she's more than welcome to surround herself with plexiglass if that makes her feel more comfortable. Meanwhile, President Trump said today that despite his active case of COVID-19, he's raring to go at it next week in Miami in the next presidential debate scheduled with Joe Biden. Nick Harper reports.
President Trump tweeted that he was looking forward to the debate and that it would be great. His campaign confirmed he would be attending the Miami event in person, even though it's still unclear if he'll be healthy enough to take part or if by doing so he could expose people, including his rival Joe Biden, to the virus. Biden has criticized Trump's post-hospital dismissal of the virus. He posted a video on release telling Americans not to fear COVID-19. Biden said there is still a lot to be concerned about. Wednesday night's vice presidential debate will see Mike Pence and Kamala Harris separated by plexiglass dividers. I'm Nick Harper in Washington.
Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden said late today that he and Trump shouldn't have a debate as long as the president remains positive for the coronavirus. Susan Page, Washington Bureau Chief at USA Today, will be the host of tomorrow's vice presidential debate. And you can hear that debate, by the way, here on KPFA, beginning at 6 o'clock. Page chooses the debate topics. In Page's 47-year career, she's covered 10 presidential elections, 6 administrations, interviewed 9 American presidents, won several awards, but there's controversy surrounding her pick as moderator. A congressional investigation revealed that in 2018, Page hosted what was labeled a Girls' Night Out event at her home for Seema Verma, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services Administrator for President Trump. According to congressional reports and a Washington Post investigation, that event cost the taxpayers nearly $3,000. And Susan Page personally paid $4,000 for the event's catering, including tips for the staff. Verma runs an agency with a $1 trillion budget and 4,000 federal employees, overseeing federal health care programs used by 145 million poor and older Americans. The congressional report outlined in detail the efforts of a team of hand-picked Republican consultants paid for by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, known as CMS, to work on Seema Verma's personal image, obtain profiles and coverage from friendly reporters, escort her during travel, write opinion articles, and even draft her Twitter posts. The cost to taxpayers, a reported $3 million. Among the expenditures billed to the CMS, $450 for a makeup artist for Verma for a video production, $500 a night bills for hotels and time from consultants whose roles included driving Seema Verma around. As head of the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, Verma has spent nearly 4 years trying to kick people off Medicaid and has been an enthusiastic advocate for eliminating the Affordable Care Act and for limiting Medicaid access for the unemployed. USA Today has defended Page's choice to host the event. Former First Lady Michelle Obama is out with a scathing new video that accuses President Trump of willful mismanagement of the coronavirus crisis and of racism.
Racism, fear, division. These are powerful weapons. Think about what would possibly compel you to accept this level of chaos, violence, and confusion under this president and be willing to watch our country continue to spiral out of control. Because we can no longer pretend that we don't know exactly who and what this president stands for.
Michelle Obama makes a special call to black and brown voters and all young voters who are considering sitting out the election, urging them to make a plan to vote. She says, "We don't have the luxury to assume that things are going to turn out okay." She urges a vote for Joe Biden if the country is to have any kind of stability. You're listening to the evening news on KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online at kpfa.org. Florida Governor Ron DeSantis is extending the state's voter registration deadline after heavy traffic crashed the state's online system and potentially prevented thousands of enrolling to cast ballots in next month's presidential election in the battleground state. DeSantis said he would extend the deadline to 7 o'clock this evening. In addition to online registration, DeSantis ordered elections, motor vehicle, and tax collectors' offices to stay open until 7 p.m. for anyone who wanted to register in person. Florida Secretary of State Laurel Lee says the online registration system was accessed by an unprecedented 1.1 million requests an hour during the last few hours of yesterday. The Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights under Law had threatened to sue if the governor did not extend the deadline. Democratic lawmakers and voting experts are blasting efforts to limit voting by mail. They're also calling on social media platforms to remove false voting information. They spoke at a Capitol hearing today on election misinformation in the 2020 election. Christopher Martinez reports.
It's 4 weeks till Election Day, and as votes are already being cast in some states, Democratic lawmakers are looking at the problem of election misinformation. A House Administration Subcommittee on Elections held a hearing Tuesday, a hearing that no Republicans attended. The subcommittee heard from several election officials and experts. Ina Jo Davis-Chappelle is a Board of Elections member in Ohio's Cuyahoga County. She says she's never before seen so many falsehoods about the election process being promoted by widespread disinformation campaigns.
These campaigns are, quote, picking divisive issues such as race, religion, and gender, planting fake news, amplifying messages via extreme fringe groups, organizing protests, and so forth, using internet and social media to launch mass influence campaigns with a goal of subversion, civil unrest, and the creation of public discord. The campaigns are exploiting grievances, building distrust and cynicism, and ultimately discouraging voter participation. Our secretary has noted that there are a number of foreign bad actors, Russia, North Korea, China, Venezuela, engaging in this campaign. Sadly, however, much of this misinformation is being promoted by President Trump, the White House, and other domestic bad actors who have unfairly demonized the vote-by-mail process and, in the process, undermined public confidence.
Representative Jamie Raskin is a Democrat from Maryland. He says the issue of disinformation is important when it comes to preserving popular democracy.
President Trump has been engaged in a lot of propagandistic disinformation already about the election, calling it a fraud, a scam, a hoax, millions of fake ballots and all of that stuff. This itself discourages and depresses voting. It demoralizes voters. It also provides a smokescreen and a fog of propaganda for state legislatures that may be trying to depress turnout and may be trying to discredit what could be a landslide popular vote based on the polls today for Joe Biden and replace the popular vote with electors that have been appointed directly by the state legislature.
Several of the witnesses emphasized the role of social media platforms like Facebook and Twitter. Spencer Overton is a Georgetown University law professor and president of the black think tank Joint Center for Political and Economic Studies. He says social media companies should remove false voting information. He says the 2016 election marked the largest decline in black voters in modern history, and so it's no surprise that similar efforts are continuing today.
Even though Mark Zuckerberg said, quote, voting is voice and it's the single most powerful expression of democracy, end of quote, he and other tech companies must take bolder action to end voter suppression. So while the Russians and the Trump campaign buy misleading ads targeted at black voters to persuade them not to vote, the Trump administration pushes to rewrite federal law so the platforms can't remove disinformation about elections.
President Donald Trump and many Republicans have taken aim at voting by mail, claiming it opens up the elections to fraud. Democratic Representative Pete Aguilar of California says the facts show otherwise.
The actual fraudulent vote by mail votes cast over the past two decades are minuscule, and there's no legitimate concern over voter fraud. Yet it's more likely for Americans to get struck by lightning than to commit mail voting fraud. Voter fraud is more rare than winning the Mega Millions. Misinformation about voting by mail is dangerous.
Colorado Secretary of State Gina Griswold says Colorado has had good experiences with voting by mail because it increases turnout and the paper ballots cannot be hacked. She took aim at voter suppression efforts. In particular, she talked about President Trump's call for supporters to go to polls as election watchers. Some people, including the attorneys general of three swing states, have blasted that as a form of voter suppression. Griswold agrees.
Those comments about the Proud Boys have real effect. As a Secretary of State responsible for ensuring that Americans from all communities have access to the polls, I think it's very important to say that voter suppression is often systemic racism. And when you have the leader of the free world calling on neo-Nazis in the election process, that is voter suppression. When you have the president calling on law enforcement, which is a tactic straight out of the Jim Crow South, that is voter suppression.
Republicans are still in court trying to alter early voting and vote-by-mail plans in several states. Witnesses at the hearing and the Democratic lawmakers say people should make a plan now for how they're going to vote. Democratic Representative Marsha Fudge of Ohio is chair of the Elections Subcommittee.
We are going to show our colleagues and the President of the United States there is nothing you can do to kill this democracy. It is bigger than you. It is stronger than you. It is more resilient than you are. And we are going to win this election. The people are going to win the election because we are going to exercise our right to vote no matter what obstacle you put in our way. No matter what roadblock you put in our way, we are going to do what this country has always done. Do what is right.
Reporting for Pacifica Radio News KPFA, I'm Christopher Martinez.
In Gettysburg, Pennsylvania today, Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden argued that the United States can overcome centuries of economic and racial divisions, along with deep partisan rifts that have accelerated in recent years. Christina Onnestead reports.
Using the symbolic backdrop of the bloodiest battle of the American Civil War, presidential candidate Democrat Joe Biden warned the U.S. again is in a dangerous place and issued a plea for the public's vote this election. Without mentioning President Donald Trump, Biden denounced the nation's political climate and positioned himself as a better leader.
Today, we're engaged once again in a battle for the soul of the nation. The forces of darkness, the forces of division, the forces of yesterday are pulling us apart, holding us down, and holding us back. We must free ourselves of all of them. As president, I will embrace hope, not fear, peace, not violence, generosity, not greed, and light, not darkness. I'll be a president who appeals to the best in us, not the worst. I'll be a president who pushes toward the future, not one who clings to the past.
Invoking the legacy of Abraham Lincoln, who led the North in a battle that won the Civil War and who signed the Emancipation Proclamation that freed slaves, Biden said the nation can overcome centuries of economic and racial divisions, along with the deep partisan rifts that have accelerated in recent years. He denounced white supremacy, which President Donald Trump refused to do during his first presidential debate with Biden, in sharp contrast to Trump's law and order campaign. Biden said the U.S. doesn't have to choose between law and order and racial justice. He cited instances of excessive police force and heart-wrenching cases of racial injustice that have inspired waves of peaceful protests across the country. But he said instances of violence and property destruction during protests couldn't be tolerated, though he said they should not obscure the larger issues of racial inequity.
Won't be easy. Our divisions today are longstanding. Economic and racial inequities have shaped us for generations. But I give you my word. I give you my word. If I'm elected president, I will marshal the ingenuity and goodwill of this nation to turn division into unity and bring us together, because I think that the people are looking for that. We can disagree about how we move forward, but we must take the first steps. And it starts with how we treat one another, how we talk to one another, how we respect one another.
The former vice president to the nation's first black president also said Americans cannot undo what has been done. But he said the nation can do so much better come November. I'm Christina Onnestad reporting for KPFA.
Don't believe the hype. That's the name of KPFA's political history collection, a collection of 15 presentations, lectures, and interviews going beyond the hype, featuring Richard Wolff and Understanding Socialism, Cornel West, Understanding the Radical Reverend Martin Luther King Jr., Greg Palast on how Trump stole or is trying to steal the 2020 election, Jason Stanley on how fascism works, David Clay Johnston on what Trump is doing for you, and Tom Paine, well, his lessons for our time. It's not actually Tom Paine himself, although he would be in the thick of it if he were around today. That collection, Don't Believe the Hype, KPFA's political history collection, is available to any of you who would like tonight during this newscast to make a financial contribution to KPFA. All we have to do is get a collective 30 of you together to do it. I need to get 30 more people to sign up, and you sign up by making a financial pledge to keep this radio station on the air, because this is the truth. This radio station does not exist without your financial support. 90%, 9 out of every 10 pennies, $9 out of every 10 expended here comes directly from you, our listeners. Without you, we can't go on, because there are no commercials, you know that. There's no commercial underwriting. You may not understand that, but believe me, there's nothing masquerading as a commercial on this radio station, as there are on lots of other public stations. There's no foundation behind this enterprise. There are no rich people. There's no think tank. There's no federal funding. 9 out of every 10 bucks comes from you, the listener. That's the truth. And I need 30 of you to make a pledge tonight during this newscast, as we are, and here's the truth, trying to raise $450,000 to keep this radio station on the air through the end of the year. And we've got 3 days left, and we've got more than $100,000 still to go. So we're getting a bit desperate, and I need 30 of you to come to our aid tonight at 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. 1-800-439-5732, kpfa.org. If you've got a little money, we'll take a little. If you've got a lot, we'll take a lot. Whatever you can afford, Whatever you can give, whatever you do give or pledge tonight, you will get 15 presentations and lectures on Not Believing the Hype, KPFA's political history collection. We need 30 of you to sign up for that deal tonight by the end of the newscast, 30 minutes from now. And we have a lot more news still to bring you. 1-800-439-5732, kpfa.org. The Food and Drug Administration has pushed back after the White House blocked formal new guidelines on bringing potential vaccine for COVID-19 to market. At issue is the FDA's planned requirement that participants in mass clinical trials for vaccine be followed for 2 months to ensure there are no side effects and the vaccines provide lasting protection. A senior administration official confirmed the White House blocked release of the FDA standard, saying Trump administration officials believe there was no clinical or medical reason for the additional requirement. The intervention by Trump officials is the latest example of the administration undercutting its own medical experts for political reasons. But Politico reports the FDA has told vaccine developers they must wait the 2 months and wait until there have been 5 severe cases of COVID among those receiving the placebo in the tests. FDA Commissioner Stephen Hahn has been attempting to shore up public confidence in the FDA's vaccine review for weeks, vowing that career scientists and not politicians will decide if the shots are safe and effective for mass vaccination. Last week, 7 former FDA commissioners blasted the Trump administration for undermining the credibility of the FDA in a Washington Post op-ed and called for the release of the pending vaccine guidelines. The former FDA chiefs warned that public fears that a vaccine was rushed out for political reasons could derail efforts to convince people that an ultimately available vaccine is safe and effective. Meanwhile, 2 former U.S. health officials have told the Associated Press that Vice President Mike Pence, back in March, directed the nation's top disease control agency to use its emergency powers to effectively seal the borders against immigrants and asylum seekers over the objections of its scientists. 3 people with direct knowledge of the situation say a top Centers for Disease Control and Prevention doctor had refused to comply with the Trump administration's directive. So Pence intervened in early March. The vice president, who had taken over the Trump administration's response to the growing pandemic, called Dr. Robert Redfield, the CDC's director, and told him to use the agency's special legal authority in a pandemic anyway. Also on the phone were Pence's chief of staff, Mark Short, and acting Homeland Security Secretary, Chad Wolf. Redfield immediately ordered his senior staff to get it done, according to a former CDC official who was not authorized to discuss internal deliberations and spoke to the AP on condition of anonymity. The CDC's order covered the U.S. borders with both Mexico and Canada, but has affected mostly the thousands of asylum seekers and immigrants arriving at the southern border. Public health experts had urged the administration to focus on a national mask mandate, enforce social distancing, and increase the number of contact tracers to track down people exposed to the virus. But Stephen Miller, top aide to President Trump, who has been a rabid opponent of all immigration, pushed for the expulsion order. Olivia Troy, a former top aide to Pence, says it was a Stephen Miller special. Troy recently resigned in protest, saying the administration had placed politics over public health. She said there was a lot of pressure on DHS and CDC to push it forward. Title 42 of the Public Health Service Act gives federal health officials unique powers during a pandemic to take extraordinary measures to limit transmission of an infectious disease. One of those is the ability to stop the flow of immigration from countries with high numbers of confirmed cases, a legal authority the CDC does not normally have. Since the order went into effect, nearly 150,000 people, including at least 8,800 unaccompanied children who are normally offered special legal protections under a court settlement and federal law, have been sent back to their countries of origin without typical due process. Many have been returned to dangerous and violent conditions in El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala. The World Health Organization warns that COVID-19 is taking an emotional toll across Europe, with rising levels of apathy among some populations. The WHO says many people are feeling less motivated about following protective behaviors after living with disruption and uncertainty for months. But the WHO insists that, although weary, people must revive their efforts to fight the virus. Tony Waterman reports from Brussels.
The WHO says upwards of 60% of people in certain areas in Europe have COVID-19 fatigue, exhibiting symptoms of weariness and apathy. To get things back on track, the health organization says governments need to understand how people are feeling, include them in decision-making, and come up with innovative ways to maintain safety while also letting people live their lives. The warning comes as coronavirus cases surge across Europe, with some countries now worse off than they were during the peak of the first wave. Tony Waterman, Brussels.
Paris shut down all its bars completely today after the French government raised the city's coronavirus alert to maximum following a period of high infection rates. On Sunday, France reported 12,565 cases of COVID-19. France's maximum alert level comes into force when the infection rate in a locality exceeds 250 infections per 100,000 people, and at least 30% of intensive care beds are reserved for COVID-19 patients. Simon Marks has the story.
The Ministry of Health says that for the first time since May, there are now over 1,400 patients relying on French intensive care units and more than 7,000 people hospitalised. And with the number of infections intensifying as colder weather arrives, starting today, bars, gyms and swimming pools are all being ordered to close as Paris comes under the maximum alert level available to the French government. Correspondent Peter Allen is there.
The figures are appalling, especially in the big cities like Paris. Just going out on the streets of Paris at any time now, you do notice it's very, very subdued. A lot of people are staying in, a lot of people are working from home, not going to work at all. And there's great concern as we push towards the winter. All bars will be shut. Restaurants will remain open, but under strict conditions. Going out for a meal will be a lot more problematic than it has been in the past. Lots of social distancing, masks being worn, and even some tracing in some restaurants as well. So this is going to go on for about 2 weeks, but it could be a rolling measure, so it could go on for a lot longer.
In the Paris region alone, the authorities say there are now more than 200 active COVID-19 clusters. With FSN Spotlight, I'm Simon Marks.
The state of Texas is spurning $5.5 billion worth of health care coverage for some 1 million Texans who do not currently have any medical insurance. Roz Brown has the story.
As states grapple with financial shortfalls due to the coronavirus pandemic, a new study shows just how much Texas could benefit by expanding Medicaid under the Affordable Care Act. Study lead Laura Diggs says at current funding rates, Medicaid expansion in Texas could bring in $5.4 billion new federal dollars and provide health coverage to nearly 1 million Texans with little cost to the state. Diggs says the unexpected health crisis illustrates why expanding Medicaid could help lower-income residents.
Medicaid is the kind of program that can make a big difference in a pandemic, especially as going forward, where hopefully we'll develop better treatments and thinking about how people are going to pay for those things.
Without health insurance, people typically forego preventive care and head to an emergency room when they're sick, creating a financial burden for the state and taxpayers. Research for the study was compiled by the Bush School of Government and Public Service and sponsored by the Episcopal Health Foundation. Texas is one of 12 states that hasn't expanded Medicaid since becoming eligible to do so with the passage of the Affordable Care Act in 2010. As a result, Texas has the nation's highest rate and total number of uninsured individuals. Digg says many Texans earning minimum wage are too poor to qualify for an ACA tax credit, but earn too much to qualify for Medicaid under the state's strict eligibility criteria.
So we have a really big eligibility gap in Texas that a lot of people in working families can fall into, and that's one of the reasons we have a high uninsured rate relative to other states.
Digg worries that when the COVID-19 vaccine is available, the cost will be out of reach for some Texans. Last year, a federal judge in Texas invalidated the Affordable Care Act, although the law remains in effect, waiting a U.S. Supreme Court ruling. For Public News Service, I'm Roz Brown.
Cal Fire says the glass fire is now 50% contained. It also updated the total number of homes destroyed in the blaze, 290 in Napa County, 310 in Sonoma. Meanwhile, Cal Fire meteorologist Tom Bird says weather conditions will improve starting tomorrow as cooler Pacific air with higher humidity pushes inland. And there's a chance of rain, albeit probably very light rain by the weekend, but Bird said he doesn't think it will be significant enough to end fire danger for the fall. Several evacuation orders in the glass fire area have now been reduced to warnings in Angwin, St. Helena, and Hope Valley. Because of COVID, most evacuees from the area have avoided emergency shelters. Instead, they're staying with friends or relatives or in hotels or even parking lots. KPFA's Corinne Smith went to interview some of the people who are at the shelters, and she filed this report.
The first night, 87-year-old Sue Hattendorf evacuated from her home in Oakmont. She slept in her car in a Kenwood shopping center parking lot.
And there were about a dozen cars there, including myself. And I had gone beyond that and then decided that I didn't want to go that any further than that away. So I came back to there, spent the night there. First thing the next morning, one of the policemen and I had a discussion. And he suggested that, and I asked him, how can I get back to the Vets Memorial where I was the last time we had this problem?
That's the Santa Rosa Veterans Memorial Hall, which is where we're talking now. It's an evacuation center with about a dozen people staying in cots spread out throughout several rooms. Because of the smoke and the coronavirus, most people with options are staying away from these shelters. Hattendorf says she's not too worried. She wears a mask, she washes her hands, and the shelter is clean, and overall she says it's comfortable. But she can't wait to go home.
I will stay here only as long as I absolutely have to. Got nothing to do with that. I just want to get back to my house.
Roughly 12 miles north in Calistoga, 79-year-old B.J. Hopgood woke up around 3 a.m. last Monday to the noise of a Nixle alert on her phone.
It sounded like a siren, and all the lights were flashing on the phone. Got out of bed and went out on my deck, and sure enough, I looked towards St. Helena, and I could see the fire, and I could see then I could see smoke and everything.
Her bags were packed already. She grabbed them, jumped in her car, then picked up an elderly friend nearby.
Well, I didn't have a plan, really, because my family was all scattering every which way, and everybody was full up to the brim with people, so I just started driving towards Napa, and I took my friend over to her daughter's house. And the daughter said, well, why don't you stay here until you can find something? So I did, and then I went back to St. Helena, but the smoke was just too bad, and so I had to get out of there. And that's why the voice is cracked, because of the smoke and all.
We're in the parking lot of Napa Valley Community College, where there is a county-run shelter. Hopgood is here to get a hotel room and is waiting for a call back from county staff with her placement. She needs to plug in her oxygen machine. It's about 95 degrees out. She's waiting in her car with the AC blasting. There's enough smoke to push the air quality index to 250, or very unhealthy. But she says she's staying positive. She lost another home to a house fire in 1992 and says it was an opportunity to start over.
And we came home about 12:30 at night, and the home was totally engulfed. So I know what it's like to lose everything. And it is a horrendous, horrendous loss. But I do have to say, for those that have lost the vote, I want them to look at the bright side. And the bright side is now you can rebuild that closet that you hated because it was there and you wanted it over there. Well, now you can put it over there. You get through it, but be happy because you're going to have some fun times ahead.
In another part of Napa, at the Crosswalk Community Church evacuation shelter, Rodney Bloom is departing for his hotel room. He's a longtime Napa Valley resident, a photographer, and former winery tour guide. He lost his housing last year and so was camping on the mountain above the community of Angwin. He watched the fire burn throughout Sunday, enveloping the community of Deer Park below. Finally, he got a ride down with a sympathetic sheriff's deputy.
So far, Angwin is just beyond lucky. It's not lucky anymore. This is the third time, starting with the Cobb fire. I would also like to be very clear about this. The pilot flying the large jet the first day was so incredibly talented and so dedicated. He stayed from dawn till just after sundown, but when he dipped that huge jumbo jet down to the flames, I had never saw him drop anything. That's how low he got, and pulled that thing straight back up with the tall trees and did it all day long. And he personally, Gavin Newsom owes him a big debt of gratitude.
Bloom says the fire came fast and the Sheriff's Department and CAL FIRE did a great job evacuating people quickly. At the shelter, too, he said the staff are very accommodating and even got him a new phone. Later that night, I call BJ Hopgood to check in. She's just gotten a hotel room. Napa County officials say the costs will be covered until the evacuation orders are lifted, and everyone hopes that will be soon. In Sonoma.
And that report from Sonoma County by KPFA's Corinne Smith. And you're listening to the evening news on KPFA Berkeley, KPFK Los Angeles, KFCF Fresno, online at kpfa.org.
Hey everyone, this is Brian Edwards-Tiekert.
And I'm Kat Brooks.
Weekday mornings, we host Upfront.
2 hours of conversation about what's in the news and what should be.
Politics, technology.
Prisons, police.
What's happening in City Hall and at the State House.
In Washington and in the streets.
That's starting at 7 a.m. right after Democracy Now.
On Upfront.
Still looking to round out our 30 financial contributors to this listener-sponsored radio station, KPFA, during this newscast, as we are entering the final 3 days of the fund drive here at KPFA, and still some $100,000, a little more than $100,000 short of our goal. 1-800-439-5732. You could be number 17 calling in your support tonight for the newscast. Or you could go online and become number 18 at kpfa.org. All of you, no matter the amount of your financial contribution to KPFA, will get a copy of KPFA's political history collection entitled Don't Believe the Hype, 15 lectures, presentations, and some interviews concerning the political history of this country. 1-800-439-5732 or online at kpfa.org. A 22-year-old white police officer has been charged with murder in the fatal shooting of a black man following a reported disturbance at a convenience store in a small East Texas town. The Texas Rangers say Jonathan Price was walking away from Wolf City police officer Sean Lucas when Lucas opened fire Saturday night, killing Price. Family and friends say Price was intervening in a domestic disturbance when he was shot. The family of an indigenous Quebec woman who died last week in a hospital where she was taunted and insulted is filing a lawsuit. Dan Karpinchuk reports.
Joyce Etchequan died in Quebec's Joliet Hospital. She had complained about stomach pains. She also used her phone to self-film while at the hospital. It showed a deeply distressed Etchequan screaming in pain and hospital staff who berated her with racist remarks and calling her stupid. Two hospital staff have since been fired over the incident. A coroner's inquest is also underway. A visibly upset Carole Dubé is Etchequan's husband.
The racist, systemic...
Dubé says he's convinced she died because of systemic racism at the Joliet Hospital. The Quebec government says there will be a public inquiry, but the Premier, François Legault, refuses to admit there is systemic racism. Over the weekend, hundreds of people took part in a protest rally in Montreal. Ghislain Picard is with the Assembly of First Nations.
It's an issue of human rights. It's an issue where, you know, our human rights, or human rights of our people have been denied. And we won't say it often enough. The system is failing and has failed our people for too long. And for changes to happen, then the political class have to wake up.
The video has led to widespread indignation, several inquiries, and a lawsuit. And it has highlighted systemic racism in healthcare, not just in Quebec, but in other provinces as well. Native leaders say they're not surprised by what happened to Etchequan, some saying for every Joyce Etchequan that comes forward, there is 100 who have not been heard. For National Native News, I'm Dan Karpinchuk.
We still need more of you to participate in this effort to keep this newscast on the air. 1-800-439-5732 with your financial contribution, or online at kpfa.org. To keep this listener-sponsored radio station on the air, alternative source of news and information and culture and music, 1-800-439-5732 to make sure we stay on the airwaves, kpfa.org, 1-800-439-5732. Looking for 30 of you to make a financial contribution by the end of this newscast, which is now just 7.5 minutes away. Online at kpfa.org, all of you will get the KPFA Political History Collection, 15 presentations on the political history of the United States, 1-800-439-5732, or online at kpfa.org. Last week, California Governor Gavin Newsom vetoed two labor bills designed to protect essential workers during the coronavirus pandemic. Labor leaders say the governor turned his back on essential workers at a time when climate-induced wildfires and a public health crisis have created extremely dangerous working conditions. KPFA's Chris Lee reports.
Both bills were drafted to protect people working in low-wage industries that have been historically staffed by people of color. One bill, Senate Bill 1257, passed both the Senate and Assembly with little opposition. Labor leaders say it came as a surprise when Governor Gavin Newsom vetoed the legislation. Socorro Diaz is a labor leader with ALMAS, Great and Day Labor Center in Sonoma County. She suffered a respiratory ailment after cleaning houses without adequate protection in the aftermath of the deadly 2018 campfire.
I feel angry with the governor because he doesn't understand the value of our work. I would love it if he went with me to my city, Santa Rosa, to see for himself how we work in dangerous conditions. Without protective equipment, more workers will get sick, as I got sick for being exposed to smoke and toxic ashes. And with the dangers of the current pandemic, we will always feel fear.
Diaz was joined by dozens of other domestic workers and supporters. Some with children in tow at a protest rally in front of the state building in San Francisco. They rallied to denounce the governor's rejection of the measure, which would have required employers to notify their workers of job hazards. It would have also entitled domestic workers and day laborers to the same workplace safety standards for workers in similar industries like janitorial services and long-term care facilities. Kimberly Alvarenga is director of the California Domestic Workers Coalition.
for, you know, for us, this, what the veto feels like for domestic workers across the state is actually a clear message from the governor that domestic workers are second-class workers, that they don't deserve the same protections that other workers already have. It's unfortunate because they don't have an economic safety net. They don't have the same choices that others have. Their choice is to work, to feed their kids or not.
A second labor bill the governor vetoed faced heavy opposition from business interests. Assembly Bill 3216 sought to require employers in the hospitality industry to first rehire the workers they laid off as a result of the coronavirus pandemic, including cases where a new owner takes over the business. The bill also originally included emergency paid sick leave and expanded family leave. Luis Auerhahn, Director of Economic and Workforce Policy at Working Partnerships USA, says this bill was drafted early in the pandemic when low-wage service workers, especially immigrant and Black workers, were laid off in droves.
Due to objections from the California Chamber of Commerce, various pieces of that bill were stripped out in various parts of the process. But what we found was that they would say, well, we can't support the bill because we have, you know, X problem with the bill. So it would be amended, next would be taken out. Then they would say, well, we still can't support it because we don't like Y. Y was taken out. So that happened over and over. And so what it ended up with was that even though the bill was amended and amended and whittled down to take out everything that the chamber said that they had a disagreement with, the chamber still lobbied the governor successfully to kill the bill.
Supporters of the bill say it would have guaranteed thousands of essential workers their jobs back after the crisis subsides. The California Chamber of Commerce labeled AB 3216 a, quote, job killer bill, unquote, which they say would have imposed an onerous and stringent process for employers and subjected them to litigation for any alleged mistakes. I'm Chris Lee, reporting for KPFA.
Democrats on the Senate Judiciary Committee are calling on the Justice Department to provide any missing materials from a questionnaire completed by Supreme Court nominee Amy Coney Barrett. Barrett, who was nominated to the High Court last month by President Trump, signed a 2006 newspaper ad sponsored by an anti-abortion group in which she said she opposed abortion on demand and defended, quote, the right to life from fertilization to the end of natural life. The ad was not included in materials Barrett provided to the Judiciary Committee for her pending Supreme Court nomination, nor in 2017 when she was nominated to the job she holds now as a Chicago-based federal appeals court judge. In a letter today signed by all 10 Democrats on the judiciary panel, lawmakers asked the Justice Department to explain the omission and confirm whether any other materials have been left out from the Senate questionnaire. If so, the department should immediately provide the materials for committee review, the senator said. A Justice Department spokeswoman said the department has received the letter and is reviewing it. Democrats don't have the votes to block Barrett's nomination, but they're trying to slow it down. A federal judge has blocked the Federal Environmental Protection Agency from allowing the dredging and filling of salt ponds in Redwood City without going through a permitting process that could stall redevelopment of the area. U.S. District Judge William Alsup ruled that the vast Redwood City ponds are waters of the United States, entitling them to protection under the Clean Water Act. The judge said the EPA, which last year ruled the ponds weren't protected, ignored its own regulations and misinterpreted legal precedent. He vacated that decision and ordered the agency to go back to the drawing board and reconsider. 1-800-439-5732. In the final 30 seconds of our attempt to get 30 of you to become financial supporters of this newscast or at kpfa.org, the Spare the Air alert for the San Francisco Bay Area extended through this Thursday. Morning clouds and sun in the San Francisco Bay Area tomorrow with highs in the mid-60s, partly cloudy inland with highs of 80 degrees.
Tune in Tuesday nights starting at 7 p.m. with La Raza Chronicles, a weekly Latinx affairs magazine program with local and international focus, highlighting the social, political, and cultural events affecting the Latinx community. After that, it's international jazz, Latin jazz, and more on bebop, kubop, and the musical truth with Avacha. At 10 p.m., it's the Reggae Express with Spliff Skankin and Tony Moses. That's Tuesday nights on 94.1 FM KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.
The following